All right, this is going to be a quick and dirty one. We're going to talk about the common cold. Everybody's had it. It's annoying. Most of the time, it doesn't even make you miss work. It's just bothersome. So rhinovirus is actually the most common cause of the common cold. It is the cause of upper respiratory tract infections worldwide. Most of these infections, as all of you know, are self-limited and don't really result in significant disease unless there's something else going on with your patient: COPD, asthma, severe immunosuppression. And this is actually really good news, because the one thing rhinovirus does have that's really tricky is that they're shapeshifters. And this is part of why there will never be, or it is highly unlikely, I guess I should say, you never say never, that there will ever be a vaccine for the common cold, because there are more than 100 distinct serotypes of rhinovirus that have been identified. And I bet you that number has already gone up. The receptor for the rhinovirus is ICAM1, which, as you guys know from your study of immunology, is pretty much expressed everywhere: epithelial cells, endothelial cells, fibroblasts, B lymphocytes. So it's got a lot of places it could hang out. Typically, the molecule acts as an adhesion molecule, kind of allowing cells to enter the site of inflammation. Rhinoviruses are picornaviruses. That means they're super, super tiny. Other picornaviruses would be things like polio. And they have a plus sense RNA virus genome and an icosahedral capsid. And that capsid is very, very stable. It is stable in the presence of heat, acid, detergent. And that's part of the reason that rhinoviruses are so easily transmitted on fomites, right? Because when the capsid is that stable to things we would use to sterilize, guess what? You can pick it up. And this is kind of an interesting picture. Because the capsid is so stable, it kind of can come together in culture to look like this pretty lattice, right? Because they're just kind of binding to each other. So like bubbles, I don't know. It's kind of nice looking. Okay, so it's unable to replicate in the gastrointestinal tract. That's actually the one thing that will kill it, because they're destroyed by stomach acid. They actually grow best at lower temperatures. And if you think about it, that kind of makes sense, because they actually grow pretty well in your nose. And your nose is actually used to help thermoregulate some of the air that you breathe, so like in cold winter months. So that's kind of a cooler area for them to grow well in. They also grow well in your mouth, your eyes, just kind of your upper respiratory tract, including your throat. Most of the viral shedding is actually going to occur as a result of your nose. And that's why, you know, people, you know, blowing their nose and whatnot, we want them to wash their hands right after. Infected cells will release bradykinin and histamine, and that's what actually gives you that characteristic runny nose when you have a cold. The release of cytokines actually kind of promotes the infection and makes you feel bad. So as you get further secretion of your type 1 interferons, it might slow the infection, but it's going to make you feel worse. So it is part of you getting over it, but you're going to feel bad until that interferon source dries up. Because there's such an incredible amount of serotypes, there really isn't much that's protective. You can find IgA and IgG made within about a week of infection, but cross-reactivity to the other strains is pretty low, and immunity wanes within a year. So yeah, you can get the exact same cold over and over and over again. I like to kind of characterize my colds when I'm sick, like, well, that cold really knocked me down, whereas this one was just a head cold. And they're probably all the same cold. Transmission, this shouldn't be difficult to understand. Person to person, hands, nasal secretions, fomites, sticky kids, things like that. Asymptomatic people are also capable of spreading the virus. So even if they already have it, it just is below the threshold where symptoms would appear. And so that's why, you know, you hear, especially in families with kids, like, oh God, you know, one kid had it really bad and gave it to my husband, and then I had it just kind of a little bit, but our other kid didn't have it at all. It totally could have been that kid that didn't have it at all that brought it into the house. So don't count that one out. Clinical syndrome, we've all had it, so I don't want to go into this. Colds occur most often in early autumn and late spring, and they actually kind of tend to reflect social patterns. So right around now, when everybody's returning to school, yep, that's cold season. This really can't be distinguished from any other pathogens like enteroviruses or paramyxoviruses. They're all just common colds. And they don't really need to be because they don't cause significant disease. And they don't really, they're not really a significant issue as far as diagnosis is concerned. Illness peaks in 3 to 4 days, but it might last as long as 10 days. And diagnosis is just kind of made on symptomatology. The big thing to know is that if you're dealing with a common cold, do not treat it with antibiotics because it's a virus. There's no vaccine and there is no antiviral. Good luck. Go buy some over-the-counter cold medicine. Feel better.